we give them another round of applause? We just and the Amandloko Loko, directed by Manda Kanurzulu. So before we go on, let me also recognize the presence in our midst of Honorable Nomagugu Simelani, member of Executive Council of KwaZulu-Natal for Health. Without wasting more of your time, let me now proceed with today's program by inviting the chairman of the Iatf Advisory Council, His Excellency Chief Olusegun Obasanjo, former president of Nigeria, to give some closing statement. Your Excellency, sir.
Director of Program, thank you very much. And I stand by the protocol that you have very ably established. On behalf of the IATF 2021 Advisory Council, it is my singular honor and indeed privilege to address you at the end of this second intra-Africa trade fair, IATF 2021. To say that my heart is full of joy will be an understatement. When the inaugural IATF ended in Cairo in 2018, and we announced the host for the second edition, it was great optimism. It was with great optimism and a strong sense of confidence that we will have a very good IATF in Kigali in 2020. Preparations kicked into full gear immediately, and we were progressing smoothly until the COVID-19 pandemic struck in early 2020. That event changed everything. It forced us to postpone the trade fair. It also created unanticipated economic challenges that affected Rwanda's ability to deliver the facilities that would have hosted the fair. The province of KwaZulu-Natal came to the rescue, but with only 4 months to prepare for such a massive undertaking, many doubted whether it was still possible to pull it off. And yet, here we are, celebrating the final day of what has been an incredibly exciting and productive event. Let me say, as I said to the Advisory Council of IATF 2021 this morning, that I congratulate all of you, and in my part of the world, in our village, where we bring out a masquerade, and your masquerade performs very well. You congratulate the audience, the masquerade, and yourself. So I congratulate you, and I congratulate myself. It is is no mean feat to pull together the seven sitting heads of state that graced the opening ceremony. And they stayed all through the ceremony that lasted for hours. To me, that is commitment towards IATF at the highest level. Through the impactful exhibitions, the IATF 2021 conference, the Trade and Investment Forum, the CANEX program, the Automotive program, the Country Days, and the AU Youth Startup Program, IATF 2021 delivered on its objectives. Participants were able to successfully take advantage of the unrivaled business collaboration and networking opportunities to make lasting connections that are already beginning to bear fruit. Excellence, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, when I look at what we have accomplished this last week, the word that comes to my mind is impressive. It is impressive that we had such an excellent turnout despite the challenges posed by the COVID-19 pandemic. It is impressive that we had such awesome display of African ingenuity and readiness to collaborate and work together. And of course, it is very impressive that so many deals and transactions were closed during these last 7 days. As we get ready to depart, I must give credit to the man who had the vision to bring Africa together under one roof for a trade fair of this nature and stature, the person of Professor Benedict Orama, President of Afreximbank Bank. I must also give credit to the person who did the human job of actually putting the trade fair together, Mrs. Kanayo Awani, Managing Director of Afreximbank's Intra-Africa Trade Initiative. I also thank the AU Commissioner for Economic Development, Trade, Industry and Mining, Ambassador Albert Muchanga, for his indefatigable effort, which has helped to put us to where we are today. Commissioner, thank you. Similarly, not much could have been achieved without the wholehearted support we received from the Secretary General of the Africa Continental Free Trade Area Secretariat, Ms. Ambassador Wenkele Mene. We owe him a debt of gratitude. Our appreciation cannot be complete without extending special thanks to our host, the government and people of KwaZulu-Natal province, and through them to the president and government of the Republic of South Africa for the excellent hospitality we have enjoyed this week. We thank you immensely for all that you have done. in particular, I must single out the Premier of KwaZulu-Natal, Mr. Sihle, Zikalala, for all the efforts he put in to make sure that this event took place. We are eternally grateful to him. And please, Honorable Pile, convey our appreciation to him. Finally, let me thank each and every one of you who accepted our invitation to come and be part of the movement for an economically united Africa. We could not have achieved the things we have achieved without you. And I mean that with all sincerity. Our consultants, our sponsors, our exhibitors, our visitors, we thank you all. Excellencies, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, as you depart, let me, on behalf of the Iatf 2021 Advisory Council, wish each and every one of you a safe journey back to your homes and meet you in Abidjan, Cote d'Ivoire in 2023. Thank you for your participation. See you 2 years from now.
Thank you very much, President Obasanjo, for that rousing message to the participants. We'll now go on to the next stage, which is to invite the Managing Director of Afreximbank's Intra-African Trade Initiative to give us a report of the on the targets for this IATF.
Thank you, Obi. Your Excellencies, allow me to stand on already established protocols. My job this afternoon is really simple. It's to give an initial, and I have to highlight, preliminary report of how we performed over the past 7 days of IATF 2021. One of the key assignments that we go into in preparing for this trade fair was to set key performance indicators. And we did that in 2019, well before COVID-19 setting. What we do with normally will be to, we drew from the lessons of IATF 2018 that held in Cairo in Egypt. What targets will be required to support the AFCFTA that was then about to be signed, and then obviously trading started in January this year, and then came up with success metrics, what would success look like. So on that note, with that context, I'm actually very happy to report on IATF 2021, a report card. So we welcomed a total of 11,828 attendees to this event physically, as against our target of 10,000. As against our target of 10,000 attendees, we had 4 country days: South Africa, Egypt, Cote d'Ivoire, and Nigeria. That was double what we had in 2018. 46 African countries were represented in the exhibition stands. In all, we had 59 countries that participated, 46 from Africa, and the rest were from outside of Africa. In all, when you take into consideration delegates, exhibitors, visitors, buyers, speakers, there were participants in IATF 2021 activities from 128 countries. Well, in terms of number of exhibitors, we also had a target of 1,100 as we kept advertising. And I'm also happy to announce that we exceeded that. So we had 1,161 exhibitors. And this cut across the various verticals, the exhibiting companies in the main arena, the creative exhibitors. So the exhibiting companies were 833. The Canex, the creative exhibitors, were 46. Youth exhibitors were 47. Auto exhibitors, 19. And virtual exhibitors, 216. As you all know, the IATF virtual, as we call it, was going on in parallel. So this was a hybrid program. And the statistics also shows that for the IATF virtual, we had over almost 27,000 registrations. So we also made a strong effort to publicize the program in the digital media. In this regard, various aspects of the program were live streamed. These were the Trade and Investment Forum, full-day live streaming, the AU Startup Programs, and the Automotive Forums were live streamed. There were side events, you know, outside of this arena that we could not live stream. We also had a lot of media coverage, TV, live TV coverage, and as well as 1,000 pieces of daily coverage across the continent in Arabic, in English, French, and Portuguese. I guess, you know, as I draw to my report to a close, and this is probably one of the key KPIs, the deals, because the trade fair is not an end in itself. It's a platform to develop business, to grow into African trade, as well as an opportunity to do business beyond here. And I'd like to highlight that even though the number I'm going to mention now is as of now, deals are still going on. We're still getting entries. As many of you know, we advertised for digital inputs into the deals. We circulated notes for people to fill their dream for their deals, and they're still being compiled. But let me now announce that as of now, we have about $36 billion in deals concluded at IATF 2021. Finally, excellencies and ladies and gentlemen, IATF also attracted 70 sponsors, out of which 51 had exhibition stands. The thing about this year's IATF was that with all the publicity, the high-profile nature of the event accentuated by the heads of state, we now started getting sponsors wanting to participate afterwards. And I would like to thank those sponsors who supported us financially to make this happen. And for those who came in last minute, we'll try and see that your fulfillment comes through in Cote d'Ivoire in 2023. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Ms. Awani. That was a good one, showing that we've made some substantial progress this IATF. So we are going to go to the next stage of this closing ceremony, which is a press conference. So in that case, I'm going to invite the following to the table here for the press conference. The media is there, so we'll ask questions from them. So I'm going to invite Your Excellency President Obasanjo, Your Excellency the Premier of KwaZulu-Natal, represented by Mr. Pile, I think. Professor Benedict Orama, President of Apraxim Bank. Excellency Ambassador Muchanga, Her Excellency Ambassador Wankele Mene. Next to President Obasanjo. Ambassador. Mm-hmm. Yes. Okay. Yes, sir. Okay. Okay, sir. So I'm going to ask the media to anybody who has a question, please raise your hand. And a microphone will come to you. Kindly indicate who you represent and also who you are directing your question to. Yes, sir, in front. Oh.
There's a hand there.
Okay, yeah. Hang up. Can we have the microphone, please? In front, there, right there. Okay. Second row here. I think I'll go to that side. So we can. No, over here. Right here, right here.
Good afternoon. My name is Koskona Duma. I am from South Africa, and my media house is Newsroom Africa. I just would like to ask about the targets for the next conference in Abidjan in Cote d'Ivoire, given the fact that this year's conference exceeded the expectations in terms of the number of attendees. Can you just ask about as well, what are you hoping to gain at the next conference, as well as the kind of thinking going forward?
You better take that.
I think that question is for the president of Apraxim Bank.
Yeah. Hello, are you hearing me?
Yes.
No, thank you very much. We just announced Abidjan as the next destination. As is a tradition, the next advisory council meeting would consider the targets, the partners, the technical team of the partners would put forward, and those would then be approved, and they become the target will be expecting to achieve in Abidjan. But to give you an indication of what is likely to happen there, in Egypt, we had 7,000 visitors. Here, the provisional figures show almost a doubling of the visitors. And if you consider the virtual attendance, then we are talking of quintupling the visitors. We have about 12,000 visitors physically. We had 27,000 virtual. So that gives you an idea, because this is a hybrid. So in Abidjan, we are likely to overcome some of the challenges that we faced here, which made some of you to face difficulties coming and some not being able to attend, basically visa problems, basically
passport problems. It's not only visa. Because we have a focus on the youth and women, some of whom have never traveled before, they didn't have passports. And in our countries, we have problems with issuing passports quickly. So we've taken all these on board, so we would make sure that they are resolved. And if they are resolved, we are likely to see an even higher number. And then with deals, provisional figures again showed an increase from 32 billion in Egypt to provisionally 36, more likely going to 40 billion. The FCFTA would have fully taken off in terms of the implementation, as in 2 years' time. So we expect many more deals, larger deal sizes, bigger amounts to be announced. Specific figures we would come to sometime next year. Thank you.
If I may add to that, we had three things that we may regard as setback for IATF 2021. One was the COVID-19 pandemic. Two was the fact that we only had 4 months to prepare when we change venue. And three was that as a result of change of venue, some of our exhibitors were not able to rise to the occasion. There were some lapses. But hopefully, this will not be the situation in Abidjan. So as the president of Afrexim said, I am expecting that we will do better in Abidjan than we have done here. And in spite of COVID-19 and all the setbacks that I mentioned, we still have done better here than we did in Cairo 3 years ago. So there's no reason why we shouldn't do better in Abidjan than we have done in Durban. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. We have a second question here.
All right. Thank you very much. My name is Adefemi Akinsanya. I'm a broadcast journalist with Arise News, which is an international network but headquartered in Nigeria. My question, since we're talking so much about the deals being done, $36 billion at least, a massive amount, which is definitely something I imagine all of you are very proud of, but perhaps another thing that many people are concerned about is the movement of people across intra-Africa. Many African countries, many Africans within those countries still struggle to travel easily within the countries of the continent. Dr. Muchanga, if you could give us a bit more insight on what you seek to do to make the travel of people easier to facilitate trade. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that very direct question. We have what we call the protocol to the Abuja Treaty relating to free movement of people, right of residence, and right of establishment. That protocol was opened for signature in 2018. And this point in time, we have about 32 countries that have signed the protocol. and about four countries that have ratified the protocol. It requires a minimum of 15 ratifications for it to enter into force.
What else?
And when it enters into force, like it is indicated, there is going to be free movement of people across Africa. Visa free. There's also going to be an African passport. And each African will decide where to reside or establish a business. In addition, there's going to be mutual recognition of academic and professional qualifications. As we wait for that to happen, the African Union has made a number of moves, one of which is to provide the African Union passports to Africans who are always traveling around the continent. These include prominent people like the ever tireless chairperson of the Advisory Council, Baba Olusegun Obasanjo, as well as business people and chief executives of regional economic communities. In addition to that, some of the countries have taken it upon themselves to issue visas on arrival for people coming from Africa. So we are slowly liberalizing movement of people. Because if we don't do that, that becomes a non-tariff barrier. It's not going to be done today. It will take some time. And during this meeting, or this intra-African trade fair, that issue of the African passport, that issue of difficulty in moving across Africa came up. And I listened, and I'm going to share the concerns with the other members of the commission when I get back to Addis Ababa. But for now, we've taken incremental steps to address that issue. And the stakeholders should also help us by lobbying your respective countries to sign and ratify the protocol. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. My name is Hope Moses Ashike from Business Day newspaper, Lagos, Nigeria. I got three questions here, sir. One, a lot of these were concluded here, worth $36 billion, as Kanayo said. My question is, what are the conditions for accessing these facilities? Secondly, the deals were mostly signed by Afreximbank. What about other development finance institutions? Are they not involved, and why are they not involved? Third, how are you going to ensure that these facilities were put into right use? Thank you very much.
President, you want to answer that? Before the president answers that, in Cairo, one of my own organizations was one of those that had a deal concluded. And the project for which that deal is concluded will be commissioned in March next year. So that's all I can say. I leave the rest to you, President Orama.
Okay, sir.
Thank you very much. The first question is not very clear. Is how are the deals assessed? Maybe you have to clarify. But with regard to the deals that are done, how are we sure that they come to fruition? How do we follow them? We do follow them. If you ask those who are exhibiting, they will tell you that they have people coming to them every day. First of all, to know the contracts they are signing and the business discussions they are having, and taking copious notes. We have also a comprehensive record of every exhibitor here, and we follow them. We are building a database of all the exhibitors, which we are putting into our portal, and also encouraging them to go into the customer due diligence repository platform to make it easier for deals to be closed, for people to be confident to deal with them. In 2018, we closed $32 billion. As we speak, $26 billion have been done, and another $2.5 billion are in the pipeline, including Baba's business, to be concluded. When I made a statement at the beginning of this event, I cited a few of such deals, and the big ones. I mentioned the dam in Tanzania, which was the largest intra-African EPC contract. $2.9 billion is under implementation as we speak. There are also deals done by smaller business people, not only from financing point of view, but transactions where people enter contract to trade with one another, which are important. So many of that, which we track. Why are out of other DFIs? I'm aware that some banks, not only DFIs, commercial banks, sign transactions. But as I said just a few minutes ago, the deals we record and track are not just deals for financing. They include partnership investments. They include trade contracts. I think this morning, Cote d'Ivoire and Nigeria signed a big contract for export of shea nuts from Cote d'Ivoire to Algeria, for example. Those are the kind of deals we record, apart from just financing. The first one of your question wasn't clear, so if you clarify.
Thank you.
So to clarify further, I mean the facilities, I mean the financing. So are they term loans in terms of interest rates? When are they going to pay back? That's what I mean, the conditions that I mean.
Oh, okay. How they are assessed? Well, it depends on the transaction. And for us, because it's not all the deals done here that financing deals that are done here, which is our reported, are present bank deals. But deals done here are commercial transactions that have been done. Yeah. You move from that and go to the financing. Some of them we had moved on and we actually closed the transactions here and signed them. They are done. There are some that we've signed the preliminary documents and we're going to then conclude. There are trade contracts that are entered into here, or investment contracts that will require financing. Those will be treated in accordance with our guidelines. And those guidelines have been refined to treat intra-African trade transactions in particular ways, and also support small and medium scale enterprises, which are sometimes, the transactions are sometimes relatively of small size. So we designed how to deal with them. Before, we were not doing directly the SMEs because we are supporting them through banks, commercial banks. But now we have an SME unit, and we have designed products that target them directly. Thank you.
Okay. Sorry, next one. Okay.
Thank you. I'm Junior Yomatek, a journalist from Cameroon Tribune newspaper. During this fair, we discussed the obstacles to intra-African trade. My question is, what needs to be done to accelerate trade across the continent? My question is addressed to His Excellency Juan Kelemene, President Obama, and as well President Obasanjo. Thank you.
Well, since you mentioned me, you call my name last, let me start first. I think one of the first things to be done has been done, and that is the Africa Continental Free Trade Agreement. That has been done. And I believe for that we should commend our leaders. There's still a lot of work to do. There's still a lot of things to put in place for it to move smoothly. But of course, the agreement is the first thing, and that has been done. There will be rule of origin. There will be nomenclature for what we have, uniformity of nomenclature for importation and all that. All those will have to come. And they are coming. But that agreement is the first thing, and that has been done. Then there's infrastructure. For me, there's hard infrastructure, road, telecommunication, transportation, and all that. We need those. They must be there. Otherwise, what you produce, how can you move them? And I believe that one of the things that will help, particularly in the area of transportation, is thriving coastal shipping in Africa, along the West African coast, along the East African coast. And these, we can get that done almost by tomorrow. So that is very important. I believe another thing that needs to be done is for you not to have to take visa to go to any African country from your country in Africa. I believe that is important. If I have been prevented from taking part in things in another country because I go to the airport and they say my visa is not ready, so I'll have to go back home. Now, in Africa, I believe the time has come when you should be able to move from A to B for business without having to go through the rigmarole of visa. And I believe that is also on its way. The other one that I will mention is, how do I do business if you have to ask me go and get hard currency? I have to look for dollar. If I don't get dollar, then the business is not going to go through. Now, why couldn't I pay whatever I want to pay, I want to buy in Cameroon, in Nigerian currency, and then the man in Cameroon or the seller in Cameroon get his or her money in CFR, and I just pay what I have to pay. And again, that is already in existence. We only have to enhance it and make it more effective. African Bank has done that, and maybe Dr. Rama will be talking a little bit about that. But the most important thing that I will put on the table that has to be done, which also has been done, is the political will and political action. I'm going beyond the political will, but political action of our leaders to continue to make this grow and enhance it through intra-African trade fair. Thank you.
Thank you. My name is David Adadevo.
You don't have anything to add? Ambassador Mene,
President,
you add something.
Thank you very much, President. I don't have much to add, because I think that you have responded to the question comprehensively. The only point I would make is this. When I was elected by the heads of states last year, they said to me, by 2035, we want to double intra-Africa trade. We want to make sure that we dismantle the colonial economic model of trade, which is this over-reliance on what Professor always reminds us about, this over-reliance on the export of primary commodities, primarily to Europe. We have to make sure that the AfCFTA succeeds to industrialize our continent, to make sure that we have trade specialization, that we export to one another value-added goods, not apples for apples, but value-added goods, which means we have to improve our productive capacity, manufacturing capacity as a continent. In order for us to succeed, we need Afreximbank as a secretariat. One of the reasons why, in my view, we have not succeeded in the WTO, and here I want to be clear, I'm not criticizing the leadership of the WTO, I'm criticizing the members of the WTO. One of the reasons why over the last 23 years we have not seen an outcome in the WTO is because of a lack of a development dimension. So here now, for the very first time, we have a trade agreement that has a very, very strong development dimension. Second, it is supported by trade finance. Afreximbank has financed over $25 billion over the last 2 decades, over $25 billion worth of trade transactions in Africa. We now have an opportunity to, through the AfCFTA, to reduce and eliminate barriers to intra-Africa trade, reduce and eliminate barriers to intra-Africa investment. Once we remove these barriers, we will need trade finance. We will need small medium enterprises that are led by women in Nigeria to do business with somebody in Kenya. We need the capital for that. That's what we have to do to make sure that this agreement succeeds. Small medium enterprises, young entrepreneurs that we saw yesterday are at the heart of what we are trying to achieve. President, let me conclude by saying trade agreements are not about the past. Trade agreements are about capturing the future. That's why young entrepreneurs have to be at the heart of what we are doing. That is what has been missing in the WTO, the development dimension, trade finance, and what President said, investment in infrastructure. Africa has an infrastructure deficit of over $100 billion. But I don't see it as a deficit, I see it as an opportunity to invest, particularly in trade, trade complementing and supporting infrastructure. So in my view, colleague, the components that we require to make this agreement a success, development dimension, inclusivity in terms of young people, small, medium enterprises, and then, of course, trade finance, as I said. If we don't have these components, I fear that our agreement will not succeed. It will benefit only the large corporations on the African continent, the ones who already have the capacity to access new markets. From Malawi to Egypt, immediately they can access a new market now that we've opened the market on the African continent. We have 39 countries today, 39 countries that have ratified and deposited their instruments of ratification. 41 countries in their national assemblies have ratified. The political commitment is there. The legal commitment is there. The continent, in my own opinion, I don't think we have seen this high level of political commitment before to make sure that we advance our continent from the condition that we have been in over the last 60 years or so. I've been fortunate enough to have been involved in this negotiation since 2010. I saw it from the very beginning. And I have never seen this high level of political commitment from our heads of states who want to make sure that our continent becomes industrialized, we create jobs for young people, and that we place ourselves as a continent on a path to success and prosperity, so that young Africans stop dying and being buried deep in the depths of the Mediterranean Ocean as they seek opportunities abroad. So this is not a trade agreement. It is for those like me who are trade lawyers, yes, it is Africa's economic development instrument. I was not in Abuja when the Abuja Treaty was adopted. I was in high school. I couldn't attend it. I would have liked to have attended the Abuja Treaty conference, but I wasn't there. But the fundamental point is this. As far back as Abuja, Lagos Plan of Action, there has been this determination that we must advance our continent in a manner that will ensure that we stop being a contributor of only 2% to global trade and output. And as I said before, when Professor invited me, we have a country, Singapore, whose contribution to global trade is 6% and above. And our contribution as a continent, all 55 of us, less than 3%. So at the heart of the challenge that we have is how do we industrialize our continent? How do we make sure that this agreement, which our heads of states had the vision to make sure that it is enacted, how do we make sure that we leverage on this market of 1.3 billion people, which is projected by the Mo Ibrahim Foundation to be close to 7 trillion United States dollars by the year 2035, combined market. So we are not going to succeed as Morocco, as Kenya, as South Africa, as Nigeria, Not a single country in our continent will be able to be globally competitive alone. We will have to leverage this market that we have and continue to and seek to be globally competitive. That's why this agreement is so important. We are not going to succeed and trade ourselves out of poverty as an individual country. We will only succeed when we as a continent integrate our market and finish the job of our founding mothers and fathers, 1963 in May. They achieved the objective of political unity. What has evaded us as a continent for so long is market integration. So we have a very unique opportunity as Africans, in my view, President. A very, very unique opportunity to significantly advance the objectives of the Organization of African Unity, to finish the job that was started by those on whose shoulders we now stand today, to make sure that we become globally competitive as a continent. We can be as globally competitive, in my view, as China and India. But what has evaded us, we keep trading with the old colonial trade patterns. We value more trade interconnectivity with the other parts of the world than ourselves. So this is the challenge of the African Continental Free Trade Area. It is to fundamentally dismantle this colonial economic model that we inherited and that we sustained for some time ourselves. And what Professor Orama says, this continued reliance on the export of primary commodities. So my view, President, is that we have a very, very unique opportunity as Africans. I don't know if we will get another opportunity if we miss this particular momentum that we have. So the FCFTA has to succeed. We don't want to remain poor as a continent forever. We want to walk tall amongst the Committee of Nations and be proud. We want to industrialize, we want to create jobs for young Africans, we want to be competitive, and that's why this trade fair is so important, because it is connecting the market to real commercial, meaningful trade on the ground. So I want to congratulate Professor Orama for his vision, for having started this trade fair, and for making sure that even in the middle of a pandemic, that we're able to convene and have a successful trade fair. So, President, I was not going to speak, but you provoked me. I had to respond because you asked me to respond. So I apologize that I gave a speech, but I wanted to underscore the importance of what we have achieved in this week. Thank you very much.
Dr. Orama, don't be Dr. Orama, don't be as provoked. Don't be as provoked as your brother, so that you will be shorter.
Thank you very much, Eva. Drawing from him, for us, the political will is there. The agreement has been signed. There are so many obstacles we have to overcome to realize the objectives of the agreement. There's one key to that, one major thing that will help us do that: money. And that is why our present bank is rising to the moment. Afreximbank Bank was created in 1993 in anticipation of what happened in 2018. It took so long for that to happen because, you know, the bank was created just after the Abuja Treaty. It took so long for that to happen. Sorry, I think how many years would we say from the African Bank, sorry, to happen. But then it happened. The benefit of it taking that long is that it made the bank stronger. No matter what we say, if we don't have money, we can't do so much to move quickly, realizing the dreams. Look at this trade fair, for example. There was what was called the All Africa Trade Fair in 1976. It held for a while, and it died. Just because perhaps it couldn't find the money to do it. Maybe we have gone cap in hand to somebody in Europe or Asia or America to beg them to give us the grant to do a trade fair we need. Even today, it costs about $20 million to do. So if we didn't have the AfreximBank, if our leaders didn't create an AfreximBank, probably we wouldn't have that. We would remain divided. We would not get the information. Baba mentioned the issue of payment. We all know that the 42 currencies we have in the continent is part of the problem. The fragmented payment infrastructure is a huge problem. That is why people want to trade to earn foreign currency rather than trading across to expand their market. Well, that AfreximBank had to take it and do in partnership with the African Union and the AFCFTA. So we put it together and it's piloting now. And we know how big it can be in changing the trade, in integrating our continent. But if you didn't have an AfreximBank, who would have done it for you? We are talking of financing intra-African trade. Until we stepped up and created an intra-African trade initiative and put a fantastic woman in charge of it, Ms. Awani, people were not talking about intra-African trade. We have bankers here. But today, people have departments of intra-African trade in their banks because AfreximBank is giving them money to do the financing. It's giving them risk-bearing facilities to take the risk. So financing intra-African trade has become a business. It has become bankable. And we need to get everybody to get into it for us to be able to get enough money to support the trade. We can't do it alone. We just need to catalyze it. And I can go on and on about what we need money to do and why we need a bank to do it. We just need to strengthen our institutions. We should not be looking out to anybody. We are in a global competition. Trade is a competition. It's like we are running a race with somebody and we expect the person we are running against to give us oxygen, to run faster than him or her. It's not possible. If we think that is the way things go, that we are deceiving ourselves. But the only thing we can say as a bank, AfreximBank, is that our support for the AFCFTA will remain strong, because we know that that is the only way we can get out of the situation we find ourselves as Africans. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is David Adadevo. I work with the Ghanaian Times in Ghana. My question goes to Professor Orama. During your presentation at the opening ceremony, you mentioned that discussions are underway to set up an adjustment facility to cushion African countries that are likely to suffer from tariff losses in terms of revenue. But that's another for, I heard His Excellency, the Secretary General of AFTA, also mentioning $10 billion. What is the exact figure? And secondly, how are we going to ensure that this money will be used for the intended purpose? It will not be diverted into other projects rather than what it's meant for. Thank you.
Okay, well, the authoritative voice for it is the AFCFTA Secretariat. What I can tell you is that we're working together. We've done the study, done the estimates over 10 years. It doesn't matter whether it's 8 or 10 billion. The amount is huge over that period. The important thing is that we are able then to put it together. And it goes back to what my earlier intervention. If we do not have an adjustment facility, we are not going to have many countries, some countries open their borders for intra-African trade. There are some countries in the continent that used tariff for as a source of revenues. For some countries, tariff as a percent of their fiscal revenues was 70%. Now you're telling the country to remove the tariff. So unless you provide a compensation mechanism to make that country to do that, they will not do it. And that tells you the importance of adjustment facility. We have some of you here, companies who want to take advantage of the business. I'm sure some of you have met some contacts here. They tell you, well, you need to produce according to this quality, according to that. You need to retool. Businesses need to retool to be able to take advantage of the market. To retool means you need capital to retool. And that is one of the things that adjustment facility will do. And of course, the adoption of the protocol, doing certain things that the protocols that are negotiated under the AFCFTA call for, requires the government to have some money to do them. Otherwise, they will not do it. Governments may not put mechanisms for assessing their standards, and so on and so forth. Again, those require some funding. We call it adjustment facility because it's not going to be there forever. It's to enable countries to adjust in an orderly manner to the new trade environment, that trading environment that the AFCFTA will emerge. But we are happy we're working together, all of us here, the AFCFTA Secretariat at the lead, we and the AU Commission working together. Our Federal Bank has already approved $1 billion to support it. We will go out to find the balance of the money, whatever it is. We shouldn't be worried about the amount. We should just be concerned. We should be concentrating on what has to be done, not whether it's $100 billion or whatever. If we need to do it, we have to do it.
Thank you, President. Unfortunately, we only have time for two more questions. Can I get a? Okay. Yes.
Thank you very much. My name is Yared Tesfai, Head of Media and Communications of Eritrea. Congratulations for Iatf 2021. We've been part, Eritrea has been part in Cairo at Iatf 2018 and 2021 Discover Eritrea. So this is a great opportunity for all Africans. There is a lot of creativity, innovations, and talent. My cautions to be more successful in 2023 in Ivory Coast, what are the plans? Are you planning to do a tour to each African countries to promote this more, because this is a great opportunity for all Africans? Thank you.
Can we take the second so that we can take the two of them together?
Okay. All right, okay, go ahead.
Good afternoon, and thank you for the opportunity. It's Kolisa Philip from the Africa Report. My question is directed to Prof. Orama. Where do you see the role of DFIs as well as institutional investors such as pension funds I know that in 2018, Afrexim Bank and the PIC entered into an agreement whereby the PIC acquired B shares and you identified infrastructure investment as a core area. I just wondered if there are other DFIs and institutional investors knocking at your door in the area of infrastructure. And then my second question is to His Excellency Mene. In terms of institution building and capacitating the Secretariat, what agreements, in addition to the grant funding you received from the Development Bank, have you entered into? Are there any more plans in the pipeline? We know that you've said that you want the vision for the Secretariat is for it to be an equivalent or to exceed what is currently known as the WTO. Thank you.
I think the two questions will be taken together. Commissioner Muchanga?
Well, the questions are not directed at me.
They are not, because there's aspect of it that is your responsibility.
Okay.
What are you going to do about, are you going to go around campaigning and all that? Well, you are AU, you have to answer that.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's
but when you have answered your point, President Rama will do his own, and the Secretary General, Ambassador Mene, will wrap up. And then, if there's anything to add, the Director of ceremony will add. If he has nothing to add, I will say goodbye.
Thank you very much, Chairperson. Out of this trade fair, we're going to prepare a report, and the report will go to the ministers and through them, the permanent representatives. So all the member states are going to be aware of the outcome of this meeting. And in conveying that report, there's always a recommendation for increased participation from member states in future trade fairs, and the number has increased this time around as indicated. But through the advisory council of the Inter-African Trade Fair, there's a very, very focused publicity campaign which reaches out to all the member states and the rest of the world. At the level of the African Union, we are always in touch with the business houses and the embassies from the rest of the world, and we make the effort to interest them to come to the Inter-African Trade Fair. And that will continue as we go towards the 2023. Thank you.
Thank you very much. You know, the infrastructure is really in the domain of the African Development Bank. We are focusing on a narrow area of it, trade enabling infrastructure and logistics. Of course, we work with our sister DFIs on the continent, and there are also others that support us strongly from outside. The Islamic Development Bank Group, the Japanese, the Chinese, the Germans, the French. These are very big supporters from long-term development financing for us. But as I said, the infrastructure space is an African Development Bank space. Thank you.
Thank you, President. Thank you very much, President. We have close to 80 people that work in the AFCFTA Secretariat, the brightest and the best Africans. We have the average age is 30 years old. We have met gender parity. You will recall that when Madam Minister Dlamini Zuma was the chairperson of the African Union Commission, she introduced gender parity. We have senior leaders that are women, most senior in the leadership of the AFCFTA. We have people from all regions of the continent. all five regions of Africa. Language representativity, we have Portuguese speakers, French speakers, English speakers, Arabic speakers, a Xhosa speaker. We have representativity throughout the AFCFTA secretariat. We have been given permission by the heads of states to recruit up to 350 officers from all over the African continent. Because as you said, I believe that this secretariat has to be as good or even better than the most efficient international organizations. That means that we get the brightest and the best Africans to be there and to work at the secretariat. I should tell you that, and President, I'll get into trouble for this, I'm sure. I received an ambassador from a European country. She said to me, Secretary General, we want to support you. We want to bring people from Brussels to help you. I said, you know, Madam Ambassador, if I need help, I'll go to China. I won't go to Brussels. I'll ask China for help if I need help. We don't need people who will come and read Article 23 for us. We are the ones who negotiated this agreement ourselves, as Africans, from the very beginning. So we don't need somebody to come and read Article 23 for us. What we need to do is what we have begun to do, and that is to build a civil servant sense of public service in the secretariat of the brightest and the best young Africans, so that we create a cadre of trade lawyers, trade economists, who will serve our continent for the next 2 to 3 decades. And we rely less on those who want to tell us and read for us Article 23. So that is my vision, that we build a cadre secretariat of the brightest and the best. We receive support from President Orama, financial support, technical support. We receive support from African Development Bank. And I think that that's important. I don't want to go cap in hand to the IMF and the World Bank and ask for this and that. I want to go to Professor Orama and ask him for support. So it's important that we build this Africanness in our trade policy, economic policy, and we rely on African institutions to support us to build what we want to achieve in 20 to 30 years' time, and that is a globally competitive continent, a globally competitive secretariat, the brightest and the best Africans from all over the continent. And we've begun to do that. I'm very proud we have the youngest people working in the African Union are with the secretariat, the youngest. They work for the AFCFTA secretariat. And that's what we should be striving for, to build capacity of our own continent. So thank you, President.
Thank you very much, Ambassador. Mr. President, I don't have a...
Honorable Pile, as representative of Premier of KwaZulu-Natal province, a word from you before you send us packing.
Thank you very much, Your Excellency and Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, members of the media. Of course, it's been an extreme privilege for us as KwaZulu-Natal, led by our Premier Sihle, Zikalala, to host the Iatf 2021. It's been repeatedly said that the time frames within which we were requested to do so, and we are delighted that it has emerged in the successful way that it has. Of course, we did convey the apology of the Premier was in the meeting in Gauteng, which he was unavoidable. So, honorable delegates, please, I hope that you have enjoyed it and that you will not just leave, but will be coming back. But may I make just a couple comments that the, I think there were two recurring themes for me to the course of the conference. That was the young people, the demographics of the continent, and as in our own country, and the energy and opportunity that that provides. And the second one was what my Honorable His Excellency Mena said about industrialization. Just put in a different way, what do we trade in? We can't be trading in goods that are made elsewhere. If we're going to advance our trade, we've got to trade in goods that are produced by ourselves. And that becomes the critical measure of how we go forward. May I also say that the add my weight to the extent that it is any weight to the political will argument. I think the fact that our president and six other heads of state attended the opening ceremony was a tremendous push, a tremendous demonstration of that political will to the agenda of the work that is envisaged in the ACFTA. So we want to thank, of course, our president and our premier. We want to thank all of those who made it possible. The last point I want to make is that it's clear that we cannot approach this massive piece of work in what we call a spray and pray approach. In KwaZulu-Natal, we've disaggregated our economy into 14 sectors and developing targeted approaches to each sector. So we have to have a monitoring and evaluation capability to measure the work we're going forward. So when His Excellency Mena says about doubling our intra-Africa trade in a particular period of time, then we need to have measurable targets for each sector, for each year as we go forward. But in conclusion, Your Excellencies, it's been an absolute honor to have hosted it. We trust that you have enjoyed it and that you will certainly, all of you, will be back, if not for anything else, but just to enjoy our warm sun, beaches, and warmth of our people. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Honorable Pile. Let me also now take the opportunity to thank the press, gentlemen and ladies of the press, for your probing questions. We'll now invite the panel to step down to the podium there for a picture, a group photograph by the panel behind there, before we move on to the next stage of the day's event. No.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen of the press. If you have a very important question or comment, send it to the managing director of IATF. She will send it to whoever has to answer, and you will get a reply. That is if you have a burning question. Otherwise, goodbye. See you in Abidjan.
So, just by the panel here. Yes. Okay. There's still one element left. The announcement of the.
All right.
Yeah. Hello? Okay. It's not yet over. They will just take the picture and then we'll finalize. So just remain seated.
Step in front.
I'm going to invite Ambassador Mchanga back to the podium. Excellency, can I invite you back to the podium? Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, we have one final assignment before. Gentlemen, I now invite, can I ask you to sit down, please? Can I ask you to take your seats?
Ladies and gentlemen, finally, and as we look ahead to IATF 2023, I'd like to announce to participants that the registration for IATF 2023 is now open. All you need go is to go to www.intraafricantradefair.com. Thank you very much, and see you all in Abidjan.
Let me also announce that you are invited to lunch. Everybody's invited to lunch, which is taking place outside. They will advise you on where to go exactly, but lunch is served. Thank you.